Well, today my conversation is with Susan McClelland. She's the author of Boy from Buchenwald, the true story of a Holocaust survivor. It's a memoir, right? And you wrote it with a Holocaust survivor. Thank you so much for talking with me here today.
Oh, well, thank you for having me.
So let's start with the man. And you know, this is from Israel. I visited Israel in 2012. A friend of mine's mom gave this to me, so I thought it would be appropriate to wear today. So tell me a little bit about the man himself.
So Robbie Waisman, who was Romek, that was his, he was born in Poland in a small community called Skarżysko Kamienna, a very Orthodox life. He was born in 1931, but the Nazis came in 1939. And so there was some attempts by his family to save him because he was so young, by giving him to families to be raised as a Christian child. But ultimately, Robbie ended up working at a German a munitions factory taken over by the Germans that was in Skarżysko. One of his brothers was there for a while, and his father, but both of them, you know, he saw or certainly heard his brother Abram, older brother Abram, being shot, and then his father. So he just, you know, he was 11, 12, 13, floated, worked there most of the war. But when the Red Army, the Russians, were coming in from the east and the Allies from the west, the Germans, feeling some, wanted to eliminate all the evidence of what they had been doing in Poland. They wanted to destroy the camps. They wanted to destroy the Jewish people. But there were some that they took in cattle cars and brought to Germany because they felt they were still valuable in some way for the war effort. And that's why Robbie survived, is that he had very long fingers and could put, you know, the things in the barrel of the gun. And then the story really starts, although we get into much of Robbie's backstory, as you know, in the book, but the story starts in Buchenwald when the American army liberates the camp. And they found more than 1,000 boys under the age of 17, 18, and just astonished that they survived, but the boy physically survived. Although at that point, the boys, they were from different countries, they spoke different languages, and when the war ended and they discovered each other, not the boys didn't know about each other in some cases, they hated each other. They began to fight each other, and they became thugs. But there was an organization called the OSE that was in France that brought the boy, 427 of the boys, the younger boys, to France, believing that they could be healed and rehabilitate from their experiences. And they do.
And he was deemed hopeless at a point in time. How did you even come to tell his story?
Well, I've written many books like this already. So I was known within publishers and agents to this kind of story. You know, not memoir, of celebrities and whatnot, but it, you know, very human stories. I had people knew about this. So I was contacted through a literary agent who knew Robbie. And that was about 5 years ago. So we've become very close, Robbie.
Yeah, I mean, it had to be intense for you telling a man's story like this. You're getting a firsthand, you know, account.
Yeah. Robbie was just very open and beautiful. Like you know, not just Robbie, but every subject I've worked with, I feel it's absolutely crucial that we have a level of trust and intimacy, not romantic, right, but a level of professional intimacy to share those experiences. And I think that's the first step that any story I do is, we have to dispel any power sort of imbalances, you know, and just be really real and raw in front of each other. And the trust has to be, you know, it has to be there, else the book won't work.
Yeah, and it's an intense book. I mean, American troops liberated Buchenwald on April 11th, 1945. 1,000 Jewish boys under the age of 18 were found there. Buchenwald was a brutal concentration camp. I think they estimate 60,000 people died there. he lost his family there, right? So how did the turnaround come? And Albert Einstein was part of this. Tell me what that connection was.
So the OSA, the organization that brought them to France, was originally founded in Russia to help survivors of the pogroms. Hmm. And then it moved to Germany. And of course, during the Holocaust, they moved it to Paris. Albert Einstein was one of the patrons or board of directors of the organization during the time when the organization decided to turn their attention to helping Jewish children during the Holocaust. And the organization didn't just bring the Buchenwald boys to France. During the Nazi occupation of France, they were hiding Jewish children as well, and moving some of them to Spain for safety. Mm. So that's Albert Einstein's role in that.
And the trauma that he experienced as a child, what was that like for him sharing that? What were some of the things he told you?
Oh, well, everything he told me is in the book. One was the anger he had towards his father. The anger he had towards his face. So the real, you know, being unable to accept that his family was dead. It was, you know, the beliefs he had in his own identity. He didn't know who he, when asked his name, he gave his number, you know, when he didn't know any other name. Yeah. He was called rat food. He saw people right beside him if they had any sort of illness, or if they were, you know, stood against the Nazis in any way, were just like shot here, there. You know, they were shot right in front of Robbie. And so it was this non-faith in humanity that this could all happen again. He was living everyone was, in survival mode, and it was just to learn to trust people again.
What do you think was the turning point for him where he had the revelation that I'm going to prevail. I'm going to win this. I'm going to contribute. He's in his 90s now, right?
He is 90. He turned 90 this year.
Wow. What do you think the turning point for him was? Where he had hope again, I guess is what I'm saying.
I don't know if we would call it hope. What Robbie will say is, so when the OSA brought the boys to France, one of the key aspects of that program was to match them up with mentors. And many of the mentors were survivors themselves, but adults. Robbie was partnered with a man named Manfred. And Robbie, he was skipping school. He was kind of like a naughty kid on summer holiday when they got to France, right? But he didn't want to take part in any of the programs. But for Robbie, it was when Manfred said, "What would your parents want for you?" And that's, you know, everything I think is, there wasn't one moment. I think that there were many moments, but I think that was a real turning point. It wasn't so much about hope. It was beginning to have some meaning again in his life. Like, if my mom was here, what would she want for me? And he will say that that was a big thing.
Wow. I mean, I was on your website. You've interviewed you've done some beautiful books on, and it seems like you're drawn to people who are inspirational, who somehow prevail, they break through. After having all those conversations with Robbie, was there something that he told you, or something that was, I guess, the most memorable thing that you learned or that he told you? There's so many, I'm sure.
Yeah, I think one of the things that sort of sent chills through me that perhaps I haven't had in my, with Robbie, I had to rely on a lot of secondary sources because of his memory, you know, his wife, the living relatives that are no longer alive now, firsthand documents. And in the documents were, that I got from the OSA, were some of the original forms of when the Nazis took him at the camp, his stamps. And, you know, when he arrived at Buchenwald, the stamps, all of that. That was really eerie for me. Yeah. And I know I've been to Holocaust centers. I've seen primary documents, but to see the primary documents of that with the subject I'm working with, I guess maybe I'd had some kind of distance for a while of not that before. So that really kind of, it made it really real.
Yeah, when I was in Israel, I visited the name I can't pronounce, but it was the Holocaust Museum, and to see those things firsthand, like history books, you can't learn them. You have to actually be there and see that. Did he happen to share with you what being a Holocaust survivor? How did that change him?
I don't know if you could even say anything about changing him. I mean, he was so young. He was what, seven or 31. So he was 8 when the Nazis invaded Poland.
Oh, wow.
But of course there was racial divides starting to happen, probably 1935, 36 onwards. So his entire life has been shaped by this. I don't think, to say it's been changed. I think it's been shaped by his experiences.
And I, you know what I thought was interesting when I was reading through the book, some really incredible people, Nobel Peace Prize winner, Elie Wiesel, he was also in that same concentration camp with Robbie. Why did Robbie wait so long to tell his story, and why now?
He did actually begin to tell a story in the 1980s, following a Holocaust denier, that he just felt it was time to speak up. Other than Eli Wiesel, I believe Robbie was one of the first Buchenwald boys to actually share his story. He began to do talks also with Leon Bass, who was part of the African-American unit that liberated Buchenwald. Leon Bass and Robbie would do a lot of talks together because they were experienced at that military unit, that the African-American units of the army, they were experiencing a lot of discrimination too. And and he also gave testimony to the Shoah Foundation, founded by Steven Spielberg, to, you know, keep the documentation. I think it was just over the year, and he founded the Holocaust Memorial Center in BC. So he was speaking decades ago, but I think it just took time for the story to become more layered, for him to actually accept some of the deeper aspects of it, for him to be writing a book.
He was like a cat with 9 lives. I mean, he had so many close calls throughout his life. You can step back and say, well, he has purpose, you know, his life, he had purpose. What do you think we can learn about surviving trauma from Robbie?
Well, it's doable. But one of the things that I talk about is that what these boys had was they had family, they had faith, they had small communities, they had a closeness in their lives in the very important years when their brain was developing before the age of 7. And Dr. Robert Krell, who Robbie founded the Holocaust Center with and who reviewed the book, he is a retired psychiatrist from the University of British Columbia. And he will say that these boys had a built-in resiliency of some sort because of their early years of being in such tight-knit communities. And that's the takeaway, is what those early years are so important for our youth. And what are we doing wrong? We have so many young people and adults with mental health issues. What are we doing wrong? And really the importance of those very crucial, from the time of the womb until 3 or 4.
And he's forgiven. What does that look like to him?
Oh, you'd have to ask him. For him, he's just lovely. Like, he's lovely. He doesn't seem to get angry. you know, he will say, what's the point of being angry, you know?
And Susan, I imagine you have a responsibility as well in telling his story.
I take it so seriously. Once we get to that level of trust between myself and the subjects I work with, I take that trust so seriously. To say there's a level of intimacy, as I said, non-romantic, that never goes away. They are always in my heart. And every word of every book I write, the subjects approve. Like that is not written with Robbie, I didn't like that. He has read every line of it and signed off on it. Mm. And I take that trust and faith that people place in me really seriously.
And you know, this book here, it's written for youth and teens. Why?
Well, Robbie, when he would give a lot of his talks, it was the young people that resonated so much with his story. And he has thousands of letters. I've seen them. I couldn't read through all of them, but tens of thousands of letters from young people really identifying with his story. And so that's why we aimed it towards the young adult readership. But I believe, you know, the vast majority of young adult readers are adults. So anyone can benefit from it. But it was really making sure that the younger adults read it. Because I think young adults, they will read a young adult book more than, oh, this is an adult memoir, you should read it.
Yeah, right. And, you know, lots of lessons about diversity. You can learn, you know, much needed things that we could use in the world right now. Here's the thing. I went to your website. I know you got to go. I've only got you for a couple minutes. You're a photographer, right? I love your photos. When did you start? What kind of camera do you use?
I wouldn't say I'm a photographer.
Oh, yes, you are. Oh my gosh. The up-close black and white of everybody. I mean, they were just powerful images.
My eldest daughter did my website and put those on there. Thank you so much. Wherever I originally, believe it or not, I wanted to do films. And so photography, wherever I've traveled, I take photos, and my photos have been used in some of my magazine articles. But I would say primarily I'm a writer. But thank you for liking my photo.
What kind of camera do you use?
Oh, a Canon. It's an old one, Revel, that my younger daughter has now taken because she makes her own films.
Oh my gosh. Well, it was gorgeous. And your website's fun to look at too. You've got the films, you've got the books, you've got the photographs. It's smcclelland.com. What's the attraction to writing stories about survival and overcoming? Because a lot of your books that I was reading about, they all are kind of like that. Inspirational.
Yeah, I don't know. Becoming a book writer was really a fluke. I was a magazine journalist, investigative and feature writer. And it was just a subject that I work with, asked me to write her book. And it's just grown from there. I love it. I love the relationship I have with the people. I don't know.
Where can people reach out to you to find more?
Through my website. And thank you. Yeah.
And I will put that on the link as well. Susan McClelland, author of Boy from Buchenwald, The True Story of a Holocaust Survivor. Thank you so much for writing it. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much.
Okay. I think I've got Patty. I'm sorry she came in. I should have had that on silence, but that's Patty.
No problem.
All right. Thank you. Bye. Thank you. Have a great day.